My name is Steve Hoffman, but in Silicon Valley, they call me Captain Hoff because I am the captain and chairman of Founderspace, one of the world's leading startup incubators and accelerators. I am also author of the best-selling book, Make Elephants Fly, which is all about the process of radical innovation. And my latest book, Surviving a Startup, which teaches entrepreneurs everything they need to know to raise capital, overcome obstacles, and scale their businesses. I work with entrepreneurs all over the globe, and I am constantly traveling, and I'm very excited to be talking about one of my favorite subjects today, the blockchain, NFTs, and cryptocurrency. The future of blockchain, crypto, and NFTs. This technology has seen an explosion over the past decade in terms of the capital inflows, trillions of dollars, boosting cryptocurrencies like Ethereum, Bitcoin, and others to astronomical levels. And some people say this is only the beginning. We are only at the tip of the iceberg. There is a massive force that is going to fundamentally change the way we live and the way we do business. So, what is the future? And where is this innovation taking us? I'm going to delve into those questions in my talk today. The power of the blockchain. What is the power of the blockchain? How can we really understand where the blockchain is headed if we don't understand the blockchain itself? Well, in order to really get our heads around the blockchain, we have to understand that the blockchain is a different type of technology. It wasn't built to do everything. There are certain technologies that can be applied across every industry in the world and actually have an enormous impact. The internet, let's say. Every industry in the world has been impacted by that. Mobile, smartphones, every business in the world has changed to adapt to mobile smartphones. AI is such a versatile technology, it can be applied to almost any problem. Anything could be made smarter and more efficient through the use of AI. However, the blockchain isn't quite as broad. In fact, it's more narrow because it was built to do one thing extremely well. The blockchain was built to power cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin. And this is a very narrow target. And the blockchain itself, by its definition, is decentralized. That means that it's really good at solving problems that require a decentralized network, not a centralized database like is used in so many businesses, government, industry applications. This means that the blockchain, by its definition, is not good at solving all types of problems. And you have to remember that if you are going to hammer in a nail, you don't want a screwdriver. Like a screwdriver is really good for screwing in screws, but really horrible as a hammer. So, whereas a traditional database and a centralized system is like a hammer, we have a specialized tool now. And it can offer an enormous amount of value. But if you're going to apply it to problems that need to be centralized, and I will tell you, most problems in the business world, most governments, they want control, meaning they don't want a decentralized system. They want to have complete control over what's happening. So when cryptocurrency was made to actually challenge that notion, to say, no, governments want to centralize and control their currencies, but we want those currencies to be open to everybody. We don't want them to be controlled by anybody. And that was the genesis, the utopian vision for the blockchain. Now we have this technology and we're applying it to all sorts of problems, not just cryptocurrency. We're applying it to tracking vaccines, to shipping products around the world, to doing medical records. You name it, the blockchain is there. But it's not going to work well for all these problems. And it's not going to work well for every business. It will only work well where there is a perfect match. And so understanding that is really important, especially if you're like me. I'm an investor. So when I invest, I have to see, is the blockchain really adding value here? Is it really enabling the end user to do something they couldn't do otherwise with a traditional database, with a traditional platform or centralized system? If it is doing that, if it is giving them unique capabilities that are really valuable, then for me, as a venture capitalist, it's a good investment. If it's not adding value, in fact, if it's making it harder to get done what needs to get done, which is true with a lot of startups I see, honestly, they're only using the blockchain because it's such, you know, there's so much hype right now around it and around cryptocurrency. So tokenizing things, all this stuff doesn't matter at the end of the day unless it creates value. That's something I want you to remember as I go through this talk. Creating value is what is going to give it a future. There is no long-term future if you aren't creating value for somebody. So who is the customer and what are they getting out of it? That is the question we need to ask when we're looking at all these different possibilities, from cryptocurrencies to NFTs to other new developments like parachains and all these things. Where do they come in? Where do they fit in? And what does the future hold for them? The largest casino in the world. I like to say the blockchain and cryptocurrency specifically has built the largest casino we have ever seen in the history of the world. Larger than Las Vegas, larger than all the casinos on the planet. This system has enabled people around the world from their homes to invest, speculate, and I would say gamble huge amounts of money. I mean, literally trillions of dollars have flowed into this space, into these cryptocurrencies, boosting them to astronomical levels. And there are those out there who say that we're only at the beginning. This is just the tip of the iceberg. We're going to see Bitcoin hit $1 million. We're going to see Ethereum go through the roof. You know, it's going to be worth 1,000 times what it is today. So will this come true? Well, honestly, nobody knows. Anybody can say anything, but nobody knows. We are going to see what will happen long term. What I can tell you, though, is that these trillions of dollars flowing into the space has been a good thing in terms of innovation. It has fueled a huge amount of development on the blockchain, developing new types of cryptocurrencies, dealing with problems of scalability that these cryptocurrencies have, the cost of smart contracts like gas on Ethereum, you know, going sky high. New cryptocurrencies are coming out to challenge that, to solve these problems. This whole DeFi ecosystem is booming right now, booming. And so I know without a doubt that people may be speculating today. People may be putting in enormous amounts of money and taking very risky bets today on all these different altcoins and everything else. But at the same time, there are a lot of very smart developers out there creating a very rich, dense ecosystem that is going to be solving problems that we can't even imagine now. So the blockchain, what we have to remember is it's not static. It is constantly evolving, constantly changing. And we are going to, and the change is really what I'm excited about. That nucleus of innovative energy, people coming up with new ideas, people taking the concepts of the blockchain and morphing them. So we're seeing hybrid blockchains, we're seeing stable coins, we're seeing systems now that can mimic stable currencies that may be adopted by governments, that may be run in parallel to governments. We're seeing new types of investment vehicles. All of this is happening today. What I want to say, though, is that if you are gambling on this, which I will tell you, you might not be, but 99% of the people out there don't understand the blockchain at all. They don't even understand what cryptocurrencies really do or what their value really is. They are just following the herd. They've heard about all these people becoming millionaires and billionaires, and everybody wants to get rich, so they're all putting in their money. That is a dangerous thing. That can create speculative bubbles. Are we in a bubble? You have to ask yourself that. If you want to protect yourself, my only piece of advice is that when playing in this casino, limit the amount you bet. Don't go over 5 or 10% of your net worth. If you stay under that amount, even if there's a collapse, even if some of these bubbles pop, you will be fine. If you go over that amount, you're taking a big risk. Which crypto to pick? This is the billion-dollar question. Everybody's asking, what's the next crypto that's going to pop? Is Bitcoin going to 1 million? Is Ethereum the next big thing? Is there another challenger coming up that's going to wipe out both of these? Well, let me give you some guidelines. First of all, when you're analyzing cryptocurrencies to make an investment, you can't just look at the hype. Like, you can't just read the headlines because those change every day. And what's hot today may be just totally gone tomorrow, and you could lose your entire investment. So unless you're really savvy and really on top of it, be careful. Also, there are people manipulating these markets, honestly. There's people putting out pump and dump, meaning they're hyping things up. They're spending a lot of money to market these new crypto altcoins. And then they'll be gone tomorrow. They'll sell all their coins and move on. And you may be stuck holding the worthless bag. When I look at cryptocurrencies, I look at the underlying value creation. This is what really drives my decision making, not just in cryptocurrencies, but across every investment I make. So first of all, is the cryptocurrency strategically positioned? What does the cryptocurrency do within the blockchain ecosystem? Are they creating some new value? Or are they creating a new ecosystem? Are they enabling an industry to do something that industry couldn't? Are they enabling businesses to actually gain efficiencies, to gain new capabilities that they don't have now? This is where the value creation lies. It's in the fact that the cryptocurrency isn't just a flashy thing, isn't just a big story. A lot of these have stories. I will tell you, stories are driving these. But stories often don't have any basis in reality. You know, go below the, you know, read below the headlines, basically. Who is using these cryptocurrencies? Why would they adopt these? What do they gain in the long term from using them? This will tell you whether it's a good long-term investment or it's literally a short-term speculative investment that you're going to buy, you know, ride it up and sell it. And hopefully you're smart enough to time it, because if you aren't, you'll probably end up losing a lot of money. I think that there's genuinely a lot of innovation going on. But that innovation, you have to understand, it's very complex out there. And you have to understand at a very deep level, not a surface level, where that innovation is taking place. And what are the problems, the roadblocks ahead that these new altcoins are going to solve? If you can do that, then you'll be much better positioned to get long-term value out of your crypto investments. The biggest IPO in history. We have seen it. Coinbase has become the number one IPO the world has ever seen. Now, why is this? Well, that is because there's so much action taking place in the cryptocurrency space today. And Coinbase is uniquely positioned to make money no matter what. It doesn't matter if those coins go up or down, Coinbase makes money on the transactions. There are a lot of other wallets out there, and there is going to be a lot of exciting opportunities in the on-ramps and off-ramps to cryptocurrency and how cryptocurrencies are integrated into various businesses. So when you're looking to place an investment, look at the infrastructure plays, look at the consumer plays, look at the plays of people building new tools around this ecosystem that make it more robust, easier to use, and ultimately will create more value. NFT collectibles. Is this the next big thing? Is this where the next boom is going to happen and you can wind up a millionaire overnight or even a billionaire? Well, yes and no. So first of all, we've already seen a lot of millionaires created, like Beeple, other artists, Banksy. These guys are selling their NFTs for huge amounts of money. And then there are the games like CryptoKitties, CryptoPunks, NBA Top Shot. Those have been doing very well, especially NBA Top Shot. They hit it right on the nose. They tapped a fan base, people who love the NBA, and they have videos that are very attractive of the top NBA stars like LeBron James. They're going for huge amounts of money. But is this sustainable? That's the question. And the answer is really, some of it is, and some of it is not. We've already seen a decline in these NFTs. Like, literally, they aren't selling as fast as they used to, and the values aren't as high. So what drives NFTs? What drives their value? And where will they go in the future? Fan-driven ecosystems. Now, this is where NFTs get really interesting. Because an NFT by itself, it doesn't have any value. I mean, there are so many things you could digitize and put up on the blockchain. Maybe people have been digitizing farts. They've been digitizing, you know, virtually anything. Their photos, their videos. It's an endless supply, and the demand simply isn't there. So the demand is created by the fan ecosystem, by these fans who value not just the digital asset, but the digital asset in the context of what it means. So let's take a fan-driven ecosystem, like manga, you know, comic books, or anime, these animations that are created out there. There are fans that are absolutely nuts over these. And if you put their favorite character, like a manga character like Naruto, out there, and you digitize these comic books and put the, you know, different frames from the comics and sell them, and they can own the exclusive rights to them, I guarantee you, people will pay money for that. And they will pay money for that as long as these comic books are valued. And I don't see them going away anytime soon. Same is true for other areas. You know, things like things that Elon Musk creates, right? And people value. Elon Musk has a huge fan base. If in the future Elon Musk isn't as popular, those things, you know, their value will dissipate. But while he's popular, the value may increase, especially if he becomes more popular. Same is true with Jack Dorsey and all these other celebrities out there, especially techno celebrities. They can drive a huge amount of value. So we're going to see NFTs becoming very valuable in the context of the containers that they're in. For example, NBA Top Shot, you know, LeBron James, you know, he already has value, has a huge number of fans. A video of him and only the exclusive rights to that has value. But that game itself, Top Shot, it will get old at some point. And at some point, even though people still care about LeBron James, they might not care about it within the ecosystem of Top Shot. And at that point, that NFT will not sustain its value. Now, you may think it will, but history has shown that, especially with games and virtual worlds, these things come and go. And so right now, there are a lot of people spending a lot of money on land in virtual worlds for NFTs of land, NFTs of homes, NFTs of other things. But we have seen in the past that things like Linden Labs actually created Second Life. It was hugely popular. It had an economy that was bigger than some countries. And people spent an inordinate amount of time creating virtual goods for these. And these virtual goods were enormously valuable for a period, you know, several years. But eventually, Linden Labs stopped innovating, and their Second Life became old. It became old. And the novelty wore off, the hype wore off, people left, and it went into a decline. Now, those virtual goods, you know, aren't worth anything. So you could have invested your whole fortune in them and they would be worth nothing. Well, this will be true of a lot of these products out there. A lot of these ecosystems simply aren't sustainable. So you have to think about that. Are you in it for the short term? Are you in it for the long term? And what does it mean? And if you're going to invest in these, you have to kind of really understand the ecosystem, understand the fan base. How committed are they? Are there other ones coming up that could displace them? All of these need to be taken into account when analyzing the value of these NFTs. NFT for games. Now, I see a bright future in NFTs for games. It's a natural fit. In fact, it's such a natural fit that it is nothing new. Virtual goods have been powering games for years. This is the core of a multi-billion dollar industry already. And owning these virtual goods on the blockchain makes natural sense. It's a natural extension of what people already do in games. So we're going to see a lot more games, especially games around celebrities and sports teams and things like that, that have huge fan bases that are going to be coming up powered, you know, underlying, powered by NFT trading. And some people are going to be able to make a lot of money on this. But they've been doing that, just so you know, in games like World of Warcraft and others for a long time. And NFTs just had a new spin on that. You know, a new way to own them, to verify them, to trade them. It creates a marketplace. So the games that have the most active users, the most passionate users, those marketplaces are going to be the most vibrant. That is where you're going to see the most value created in terms of NFT inside the gaming world. And a lot of this will be in virtual worlds, but it will really span all types of games, from casual games to hardcore games. NFTs versus copyrights. This is something a lot of people don't understand. They get confused. They think that if I own the NFT, I own that digital object. I own it in perpetuity, and I have all the rights associated with it. Not true. When you own an NFT, you really only own a document with limited rights that points to a digital asset. Now, there are a couple things you need to be aware of. First of all, the ownership of that you have can be limited. For example, in the very popular game NBA Top Shot, they give you ownership over these videos, but only in context of the game Top Shot. So you own the video within the game Top Shot. And even there, your ownership is limited. If you do anything with that video, let's say the video of LeBron James, that the NBA deems inappropriate for any reason, they can literally take it back. You will no longer own, you will have to forfeit in the terms and conditions. You will have to forfeit your right to that NFT. You do not have the right to use that video in any way you want. In fact, if you display it on a website that the NBA doesn't approve of, you can lose it. If you change that video or alter it in any way, you can lose it. So you don't, do you really own it? No. It's not that, and you can't monetize it except for selling it as it is. You can't like sublicense it and do all these other things. It's not a copyright. Copyright law and NFTs are two entirely separate things. And you, people investing in these and people trading these need to understand this. You know, you could spend huge amounts of money on a digital artwork and really wind up owning nothing more than a little document on the blockchain that points to an asset on a server. And honestly, if that server goes away, like if the Top Shot game goes away, or another server hosting Beeple's, you know, image goes away, then you've lost it forever. Now, this will change. NFTs will become more sophisticated, but the initial version of them is fairly crude, and it's divorced from legal laws, copyright laws around the world. So I'm excited because in the future, we're going to see this ecosystem develop. And what we're going to see is kind of a merging of NFTs and copyrights, where people have a much better understanding of what they're buying and of what the rights associated with those NFTs are. So in the future, maybe all copyrights globally will be on the blockchain. In fact, it's a very good use of the blockchain to actually make it work for copyrights, for collecting royalties, for controlling ownership so people don't use it inappropriately, all of these things. I can see where almost every digital asset is put onto the blockchain in the future and controlled that way in a seamless way tied into smart contracts and everything else. It can be a beautiful thing. And it is really where DeFi and where this whole ecosystem of the blockchain makes a lot of sense. But we're not there yet. So if you're investing in NFTs right now, you're investing mostly on hype. You're investing on potential. But you've got to be very aware that the pitfalls are out there. The future of the blockchain. So where is this blockchain headed? Is it going to be mostly focused, like right now, on cryptocurrencies? Are we going to see it applied to all sorts of other problems? Well, I honestly believe in its current form, it's difficult to apply to a lot of problems because most businesses and all governments like to keep control. Keeping control means they want something centralized. Their marketplaces, their systems are built on this. Think of Amazon. Think of Facebook, Alibaba, Google. They've created these incredibly powerful two-way marketplaces where people are exchanging value, but they control it all. They don't want to give that out. They don't want DeFi. They don't want decentralization. They want to have it in their databases and them at the center of this. They are the platform. They are the hub. However, decentralization offers a lot of value that they would like to access. You know, and how do they do that? How is it going to change? So what we're going to see are hybrid systems that offer the best of both. The best of centralization with the best of decentralization. And that's where it gets really interesting, where these two worlds start to combine. And as we see in the future, that many of the features that are developed in the DeFi community will be taken over into traditional marketplaces, traditional platforms, traditional databases. They will start incorporating these until we may not even see the difference between the blockchain and the internet. The two worlds will probably merge at some point. Just like, you know, right now, there used to be a thing where everybody's talking about mobile first, mobile first. Well, right now, mobile is everything, right? Everything is mobile. It doesn't matter. And in the same way, the blockchain and the internet, the different pieces are coming together. The companies building these different pieces, these bridges between the two, and the functionality between the two, creating value on both sides of the equation, they are going to be extremely valuable in themselves. Digital everything. I like to say we're entering a parallel digital universe. Like everything that can be digitized is being digitized. So our entire world is changing right now. Like we are literally creating digital twins of every activity, every process, every person, both on, you know, that is online and that is offline. They are coming together. This digital transformation will only accelerate. It's going to get bigger, faster, better over time. And the blockchain can add an enormous amount of value here. So as everything comes together, the blockchain will be one of the things uniting the physical, real, actual world and the digital world, which right now the economy of the digital world is like enormous. And it's going to just become bigger and bigger and bigger as more and more of our lives are put into digital, more and more of our businesses are brought online, as every process that we do in our lives, in industry, in government, is taken online. The bionet. Right now, our bodies, most of us do not have chips and electronics embedded in our bodies. But that is changing. Like we may wear a smartwatch, we may carry our phone with us everywhere, but in the future, all of us are going to be embedding technology into our body, whether it's nanotechnology, whether it's microchips, whether it's, you know, brain chips that Elon Musk wants to insert brain chips, whatever it is, our bodies are becoming, are going to merge with our technology. And as this happens, we are going to need some protection. You know, the internet of the body is already under development. So people are developing these technologies that go far beyond like a traditional pacemaker that somebody may put in there to keep their heart going. But for regulating all of our biological functions, this technology is on its way. And as we incorporate this, we don't want it hacked. We want control over it. And we don't want to hand that control necessarily off to a government or a corporation. And that is where decentralization becomes really important. Like, if I am going to know that my body shouldn't be tampered with unless I give approval and it's a legitimate source, I am going to want to use some technology like the blockchain to encrypt all the electronics on my body on and have them out there being validated through the mechanisms of the blockchain to make sure that I don't get hacked. Blockchain of the brain. This becomes even more powerful when you think about the brain, the human brain. It is inevitable that we are going to be using brain-computer interfaces, whether there's something like a chip that you actually insert into the brain or more likely, a non-invasive device that you wear on your head or put behind your ears that is able to read your thoughts and facilitate two-way communication between who you are, what you think, and the internet. Now, the benefits of this are enormous. Like, literally, I could pull down any information from the internet. Boom. I don't have to remember anything because all the information is out there. I don't even have to compute because I can use the cloud to compute things. I can translate languages instantly. I can access all the data in the world and process it, you know, in a nanosecond. This technology is going to be enormously powerful. It's going to take humanity to the next level. But essential to this will be our security. Like, how do we protect? It's one thing to have your identity stolen, like your, you know, your social security number, your driver's license, and then somebody, you know, starts to mess with your financials and make purchases under your name. That's horrible when that happens. But imagine having your real identity stolen, having your thoughts stolen, having somebody potentially, if you have a brain-computer interface, implanting thoughts in your head. We are going to, before we adopt this technology, we're going to have to be darn sure that this, that ourselves, who we are, our brains, are protected. And one of the best tools out there, although it hasn't been applied to this yet, is potentially the blockchain. So we're going to need the equivalent of the blockchain for the brain. A blockchain where there's no central authority that can go in and hack you. In fact, nobody can hack you without your key, and you hold the keys. And those keys are secured by the mechanism of the blockchain itself. So we're going to see a future blockchain for the brain, where literally all of our thoughts are validated, all the information we pull down, anything we read, write, goes through this blockchain, and that gives us the comfort and the knowledge that we aren't being tampered with. We aren't having our most precious organ, our brain, rewritten by somebody out there in cyberspace, some nefarious force. I see this, when this technology is in place, along with the technology for advanced brain-computer interfaces, it's literally going to transform the way we interact with our world. Hyperlayers. The world we're entering is a world of hyperlayers. There won't just be one reality out there. In fact, because of augmented reality, virtual reality, the transformation of ourselves from biological beings into digital beings, having parallel digital selves, we will be inhabiting many different layers at once. We will be moving between these layers. And all the commerce, all the exchanges, all of this will be happening, will need to be powered. We'll need the infrastructure for that. Who is going to control this multi-layered world? Will it be centralized corporations? Will it be centralized governments? Or will it be something independent and new? And this is where the blockchain, cryptocurrencies have enormous potential to transform our lives, to actually start to regulate these different layers, the rules by which they operate on, and how we interact with them. I am really excited because I know that within my lifetime, within most people's lifetime, we will actually be able to move through a world, and I will look through my eyes and I will see one world. You will look through your eyes and you will see another world, but then we can sync up and meet either in the physical world, but much more likely a combination of a digital physical world layered on top of each other, where it's a reality being created in real time dynamically by me placing stuff in the digital world and my digital self, my physical self, you, your digital self, your physical self, all interacting seamlessly. And different people, even though they're in the same physical space, might have very different augmented virtual experiences within that space and see different things. And we will be programming this. Transactions will be taking place constantly as we move through the world. This requires a whole new infrastructure. And this is where ideas like decentralization are extremely powerful because, you know, I think most people will gravitate towards the systems where they have the greatest control over their privacy, over their identity, over their lives. So we're going to see people negotiating this with companies, and companies will have to compete to offer this, and then they will be able to monetize it. And all of us will be able to monetize it. It's a very exciting space that will be constantly evolving, and we are just at the very beginning of this. We've taken the first baby steps in that direction. The digital self. Let me wrap this up by saying we are going to be spending more time than ever in the digital world. And as we do that, the value of our digital self will continue to increase. We can already see it today. Like, I know people who spend enormous amount of time on Instagram or WeChat or Snapchat or TikTok, whatever it is. They're spending so much time on it, more than they do with their real friends. But this is only going to grow more powerful as we socialize, as we do business, as we engage in virtual experiences together that challenge real life and their richness and their texture and the amount of rewarding emotional feedback they can give us. This is going to become a bigger and bigger part of our lives. And as we make this transition, we are going to need all the tools to navigate through a world where our digital self is ourself. It is who we are. It is what we value. And those transactions, how we interface with each other, how we interface monetarily with an economic system, how we build our lives in the different virtual goods we value, all of these things need an infrastructure. And honestly, I think we're building that infrastructure today in what we see as the core of the blockchain, DeFi, decentralized movement. That is kind of the beginning. When that comes together with our digital selves, we're going to see a transformation in how we live our lives and where we go in the future. I hope you enjoyed the talk. If you liked it, you can come to founderspace.com. You can check out our latest events, contact us, and see my latest books, Make Elephants Fly, Surviving a Startup, and The Five Forces. You can also find me on all the major social networks. Just search for Founderspace.